Ladies and gentlemen, coming to the stage right now is my favorite preacher of all time. Reggie Dabbs is one of the greatest heroes and big brothers in my life. Remember when I told you last week with Dave Reaver, I was 13 years old, and I saw Dave Reaver on a stage, and I went, I'm gonna be him. When I was 16 years old, I saw Reggie traveling with Dave, and I went, black people can do this? He literally was and is my spiritual big brother that taught me how to serve kids in schools, how to speak and communicate to people for change. He taught me how to love people and be real everywhere. Be the same person on stage as you are off the stage. He's not just a good example. He's a world-renowned voice. There's not a continent he hasn't been on. There isn't a state he hasn't spoken in. He's the number one most requested motivational speaker in public schools and the most highly requested interdenominational communicator in our nation. He has preached in the largest stadiums and coliseums. He has spoken to nearly every NFL and nearly every NBA basketball and football teams. He is a world-dominating, life-changing speaker and preacher of the gospel. Ladies and gentlemen, my brother and your friend, Reggie Dabbs.
Good morning, church. How you doing? Somebody do me a favor. Just look at somebody beside you, stare them in the eye, and just say, all right, all right, all right. That tells you right there, I'm from Dallas, Texas. It is good to be with you this morning. I saw the lineup of the preachers you have coming. I feel comfortable that I can say whatever I want now. Last week you had Dave Reaver. Next week you got Rich Wilkerson Sr. My goodness. Look at your church. I don't think you're ready for me. But I got nowhere else to go, y'all. So we might as well have church to your pastor and his bride and their children. They're getting bigger and bigger and bigger. But I love them. That's why I'm here. Hopefully it won't be the last time you see me here. My wife told me not to mess up today. She said, behave. So I'm going to do my best to behave. But I was born right up the road, right up I-40 in Knoxville, Tennessee. I am a Tennessee volunteer. My blood ain't red, it's orange. And today we're gonna have a good time. Y'all ready? Yeah. I said, are you ready? Yeah. Now let me help you out. Being born in the South, raised in the South, living in the South, I'm one of those Southern preachers. Y'all hear what I'm saying here? Some of you may not understand it, but if you've seen a Madea movie, it's gonna go that way. I'm just trying to behave like my wife told me to, all right? So let's get this thing started by telling you that if you got a Bible, you need to turn to the book of John, chapter 16. John, chapter 16. Now, for those of you who are sophisticated and you don't know, let me tell you what we're going to do today. There's three rules. Number one, you have to talk to your neighbor. So everybody look at your neighbor and say, I'm going to talk to you today. Number two, you got to talk to the preacher. Somebody say, come on, Reggie. Ooh, that's good. I know I'm in the South. This is good. Number three, you just have a good time. No matter what you do, just have a good time. And we're going to do that. Let me read the scripture to you. Oh, by the way, let me help you out. All good Southern preachers, we title our sermons. So I have a title for you today, but you got to say it to your neighbor. So everybody look at somebody beside you, stare them in the eye, and just say, everything's going to be all right. Turn to the person on the other side of you. Do it again. Say, everything's going to be all right. Here we go. John chapter 16, verse number 33. The Bible says, everybody say, the Bible says. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. Oh, let me give it to you one more time because I only had two people give me a reaction. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. You know what he said? He said, in me you will have peace. Not in your situation, not in your government, not in who you're married to, not in how much money you have, not in yesterday, but in Jesus we find our peace. Why? He died and rose again. His tomb is empty. He made a way out of no way. He turned my dark. Oh, I got to stop. I am going black way too soon in Winston-Salem this morning. In him we find our peace. In this world we will have trouble. If you're going through trouble today, you're right where God wants you to be. If you're in hurt today, you're right where he wants you to be. Because he simply says you can take heart in your trouble because he has overcome the world. Amen? Now, somehow today, I've got to convince you to take a trip with me. Just go for a ride with Reggie. Would y'all go for a ride for me? Yes, sir. Now, when we get in the car and put on your seatbelt, since I'm driving, I'm in charge of the tunes. And I like having tunes. Yes, so today, before we go on a little ride, I got to turn on the radio and see what tunes we're going to have. So I might as well do it. I was told I had to do this today, so... So I need everybody, do me a favor. Just take one hand and go like this. Take the other hand and go like that. And on three, I want you to push them together as fast as you can. Ready? One, two, three. That's called a clap. And you're going to need that, all right? You're going to need that. Because I'm going to take you to the Smoky Mountains where I grew up in East Tennessee, and I'm going to drop a little Smoky Mountain Sunday morning music on y'all. I'm not just a speaker. I'm also. I know. Some of y'all like, either he really big or that's a little horn. Both. This is a soprano saxophone. And I want to do a little song for y'all. It simply says, my deliverer. Everybody put those hands like that on three. Push them together. One, two, three.
All right, good. We good. Here we go.
Come on, down. Just clap them with me. Come on, put them together. Here we go. Somebody say, all right, all right, all right. You awake yet? I'm sweating now. It's all right. I'm not sick or nothing. All black preachers sweat. If you ever have a black preacher and he don't sweat, he ain't black. Now that we got the music going, let's go down the road. Our first stop is at a little girl's house. She's in middle school. She's an eighth grader. Her name is Tayra. Everybody say Tayra. Tayra was on the volleyball team. She's in student government. Tayra loves school. But Tayra, her favorite week in the year was December 26th to January 1st. Because on that last week of the year, every year, her and her mom and dad would get on a plane in Dallas, Texas, and fly to Denver, Colorado, and get a rental car and go up into the mountains. And for 1 week, she goes snow skiing. 1 year, they got up early. When they got to the mountain, it's like 11 in the morning. She grabbed her skis. Her dad grabbed his skis. Her mom grabbed her book. Now, mama dressed like a skier. Mama looked like a skier. But mama don't ski, all right? But her and her daddy went up the lift, came down the hill, went up a second time, came down. I don't know if y'all know this, but it gets dark in Denver pretty quick in the wintertime. So it was time. They said, Dad said we can only go halfway. So they went halfway up and they started coming down. The dad was in front of his daughter. All he knew was he knew her voice. And all he heard was her just go, ah! When he hit his brakes and turned, his little girl is laying by a tree. Even though she had a helmet on, her skis got crossed and she bumped her head. She was unconscious. They called an ambulance. They brought a sled. They put her in, took her to the hospital. Fast forward 3 hours. A doctor comes out a door that says, do not enter. Walks over to Tayra's mom and dad and simply says, I'm sorry. There's nothing we can do. In 1 hour, we'll turn off the machine that's keeping your baby alive. I'm sorry for your loss. If you do not understand Tayra, then we'll go down the road a little further and maybe you can understand a girl named Heather. Everybody say Heather. Heather lived in the greater Atlanta area with her mom and dad, 5 brothers and 2 sisters. Her dad was a surgeon, worked for 7 different hospitals. You know you good when you work for 7 different hospitals. And he was good. He would get up and be gone before the kids got up to go to school. When they came home, he would still be gone. But they knew, they just hang in there. He would take a 4-week vacation. 2 of those weeks, they would go anywhere they wanted to go. So they knew they'd get their daddy time, but they also knew he was saving lives. Now, 1 of those weeks, I think you might like this. Everybody touch your neighbor and say, you might like this. 1 of those weeks, he packed his bags and he flew to the continent of Africa, north, south, east, west, even the Muslim country. He loved the Muslim country. He would go and do surgery on people that the doctors in Africa would not touch because they had HIV/AIDS. But he would go, I love this. He would do surgery, saving people's lives. But in the consult before the surgery, he would tell the family, yes, I'm from America. Yes, I came to Africa. After I do this surgery, I want you to bring your aunts, your uncles, your cousins, your brothers, your sisters, and I'll tell you why I did the surgery. And after he healed with his hands through God's help, their loved ones, he would tell them after the surgery that Jesus is his Lord and Savior and that Jesus gave him the ability to come to Africa. He led Muslims to Christ. He led family. He led 120 people to Christ in one boardroom one day. Why? Because that's what he did. And you know what Heather wanted? She wanted to be just like her daddy. So she went to school. She made straight A's. I almost shake when I have to tell you this next part. She even went to Duke Medical because she didn't hear from God and came to Wake Forest. Y'all like the way I added that? She did what she did to the point to where she became a doctor, to the point to where she got to pack her bags, go to Africa, and lead people to Christ. Come on, clap your hands. If it's a generation curse, it could be a generational blessing. Everybody touch your neighbor and say, one day. Don't you hate it when that happens? But one day, Everything was great. But one day, I did a wedding a couple of weeks ago, and at the reception, this guy looked at me and went, "Oh, that was a great wedding. That was great. But one day it's going to happen." I said, "Shut up." I had to shut him down. What's wrong with people like that? I hate cowboy fans like that. We're up by 21. They're like, "We're going to lose." Just get away. I don't want you to be my friend no more. She was in Africa. She did a surgery. She met with 67 people, all Muslims, and led them to Christ in the boardroom. She could not wait for her dad to hear what she did, but she knew he was in surgery, and he had another hour and a half, so she went and got him some dinner. She was waiting. She knew he had another hour left, but he came out of the surgery room, and she's like, "What's wrong?" She met him in the prep room. He put his hand under the water, and he was mumbling. The dad was saying, "No, no, no, Jesus, help me, Jesus, help me." He had cut his hand doing surgery on someone highly affected with HIV/AIDS. There's a medicine you could take to fight that effect in your body when your blood mixes with their blood. He took it and found out he's highly allergic. Now he's got to get back to America as fast as possible. There was a flight from Johannesburg to America. She got on the plane with her dad. He was in 21A. She was in 21B. As the plane took off, she was taking his vitals. She realized with all the education that Duke gave her, it told her that he would not make it across the ocean, that he would die on the plane unless something miracle happened. When he fell asleep after the plane took off, she went to the bathroom, locked the door, and started to beg God to save her dad. Save her dad. If you don't understand Tara and you do not understand Heather, now I know some of you are sitting there and you're looking up here going, "I tell you what, this could be the most depressing sermon I've ever heard in my entire life." It's going to get worse. Because I still got two more people, all right? Everybody touch your neighbor and say, "Trust in God." Did y'all get that? In John chapter 14, verse 1, John 14, 1, look what the Bible says. It says, "Do not let your heart be troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me." Oh, by the way, that's Jesus talking. "Do not let your heart be troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me." This morning, I'm going to be honest, as this sermon was in my heart, I started thinking to myself, I said, "God, who's going to be in that church this morning? Who's going to need this word this morning? Who is it?" So I'm going to tell you right now, I don't know what road you're walking on, but guess what? We're at the intersection this morning, and I'm glad you came. Why? I ain't nothing but the biggest, blackest Hallmark greeting card from heaven you've ever seen in your entire life, and I'm here to tell you, trust in him. No matter what it is, trust in him. Somebody touch your neighbor and say, "Everything's going to be all right." Touch your other neighbor and say, "Everything's going to be all right." Is everybody okay? Am I not yelling? Should I bring it down a notch? Am I yelling too much? You have a Pastor Allen. I know he yells. This little boy walked in this classroom for the first day. He's 6 years old, first grade. Teacher was at the door. The teacher said, "Find a desk with your name on it. When the bell rings, we'll take attendance. We'll start our school year." That little boy ran around, found the desk with his name. When he sat down and the bell rang, there are 32 kids in the classroom. Teacher started taking attendance. Let's go back to school. Throughout the course of time, teachers have taken attendance in school. So what do? They say your first name and your, except this boy. All the teacher said was his first name. She did it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. On Wednesday, the boy got to school early. He walked around and he noticed everybody's desk had a first and last name but his. All his said was his first name. He didn't say nothing. By the end of the week, every day, Monday through Friday, teacher takes attendance. Everyone had two names. He had one. So finally, he had to know. So on Friday, he raised his hand. She said, "If you got a question, walk up front." He walked up front and he said, "Excuse me, everybody's desk has two names but mine. When you take attendance, everybody has two names but me. What's up with that? Where's my name?" And the teacher said, "I'm sorry, but you don't have a last name." I ain't never heard nothing like that before. He didn't say nothing. He just went back to his seat and sat down. A week and a half later, it was parent-teacher conference. Hey, do y'all remember parent-teacher conference? I hate that day. If you hate that day, clap your hands. You hate that day. Hate that day. Now we know who the bad kids were at school. The youth pastor was clapping really hard, bro. Yeah, I could tell you were bad, bro. You were a bad man. This boy's name was the first one on the list. Both his mom and dad showed up. When they sit down, the teacher talked for 5 minutes. When it was over, they walked outside. He noticed something. The boy did. All his friends were with their parents. All his friends' parents were young, but his parents were like old. So he waited till they got in the car. He in the back seat, they're in the front seat. They're pulling out of the school parking lot. So the boy yells to the front seat, "Hey, why y'all old? Don't ever do that, all right? Little brother, look at me. If you think your people old, keep it to yourself, man. I just helped you today, all right?" When they got home, the dad said, "We got to talk." Oh, here we go. So they put the boy at the kitchen table to have a talk. Anybody ever been to the kitchen table to have a talk? If you haven't, don't go. But look at me, little girl. If you don't smell food, run, girl, run, okay? I'm taking care of all the children on a Sunday morning, all right? A little boy sitting at the kitchen table, the dad said, "Son, there's a plan for your life." He said, "Yes, sir." The mom looked at him and said, "Baby, I'm sorry." And the mom started crying. The mama cried so hard that the dad moved chairs, held the mom for 10 minutes. After 10 minutes, the dad said to his wife, tell him now. The little boy was like, "What's wrong, mom?" And the mom kept crying. Finally, the dad said, "You got to tell him." And when the mom opened her mouth, it crushed this little boy on the inside. All she said was, "Baby, I'm sorry. I'm old because I'm not your mom." And the dad whispered, "I'm not your father." Then she said, "You have a brother. His name is Keith. You have two sisters, Anna and Jeanette. Your mom kept your brother. Your mom kept your sisters. But your mama said that you were a mistake and she hated the day that you were born. But that's okay. She gave you to me. Are you all right?" And the little boy said, "I'm fine, mom. I'm fine. Thank you for taking care of me." Gave her a hug, kissed his foster care dad and said, "I got to go to bed. I got to go to school tomorrow." And he went to his bedroom and he started to cry. Every night he cried himself to sleep. 7 years old, 8, 9, 10 years old, 11, 12. By 13, he didn't talk to many people. He was a very quiet boy. At 13 years old, though, something happened. It was 3 o'clock on a Thursday morning. He wide awake. Anybody ever wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning just staring at the ceiling? He had a little red clock with red numbers, you know what I'm talking about? 300. Then the voice in his head said something he'd never said before. The voice in his head said, "You should give up. Nobody cares about you. If you were to disappear, no one would look for you. Your own mama didn't want you. You should give up. You should give up." And the boy started to cry because he started to think about giving up on the gift of life. When he started to cry, that's when it happened. His bedroom door opened. Look at me. If your bedroom door opens at 3 o'clock in the morning, run. Forget scary movies. Don't you? Why? Who loves scary movies? Put your hand down. What's wrong with you? Y'all know why you like scary movies? Ain't nobody ever told you the truth. Well, welcome to church. I'm gonna tell you the truth. You know why Reggie don't like scary movies? Black people die first in scary movies, all right? I ain't going out like that. Some of y'all thought it was gonna be spiritual, didn't you? If you black, that's as spiritual as you needed to get. Oh, by the way, if you Latino, you next. All right, here we go. Everybody look at your neighbor and say, "Where's my pastor?" It was his foster care dad who walked in the bedroom. Watch this. This boy's foster care dad walked over and said, "Are you okay? I heard you crying." The little boy said, "How? Your room's on the other end of the house. It ain't like I was doing the ugly boy cry." But the dad started laughing. The dad said, "Son, every day you hug your mom, but for the past 2 days you haven't. Every day you talk to me for 2 days, not one word. So last night and tonight after your mom fell asleep, I grabbed a pillow. And for the past 2 nights, I slept by your door. And this morning I heard you cry. What's wrong?" And all the boy said was, "I don't know what to do." And this foster care dad said, "I'll never call you by your name. I'll always call you son. And I'll love you till the day I die." If you don't understand that boy, if you don't understand Heather, if you don't understand Tara, I only got one more shot with you. I only got one more stop on our ride. Her name's Shannon. Oh, by the way, for those of you who are highly depressed, I've done this really good because, you see, I've only given you half the stories. And after I get done with Shannon, I'm going to go back to Tara. And I'm going to give you the rest of the story. Because the Bible says, trust in me. It ain't over until God takes over. I don't think y'all understand what I'm saying this morning. It ain't over till God takes over. Now, let me help you out. We've come to the point in our sermon this morning that you need to make a choice. Listen to me very carefully. Let me tell you what you're up against. I'm that dude. I am that brother. The more you hear me speak, the more in jeopardy sin is at leaving you. If you love sin, let me put it in the words of my Dallas friend. If you nasty and you like your nastiness, then you need to pretend you got to go. You need to get your stuff and you need to get as far away from my voice as you possibly can. Because the longer you hear this sermon, the more in jeopardy your nasty is at leaving you in the name of Jesus Christ. So if you got to go, you need to go now. Do you know what I just did? Ain't nobody gonna go now. Because if you get up, your whole row gonna go, mm-hmm. Y'all know she nasty, I'm just saying. Shannon, she was a senior in high school, point guard on the basketball team, worked Thursday night at the pizzeria. She loved her life. She lived in a farm community in Iowa. I don't know if you've ever been to Iowa. There ain't nothing there but corn. But she did something that, help me out. Tell me if I ain't right. Has anyone in this room ever done what she did? Let me explain. Here's what Shannon did. She woke up one weekday morning, and she reached over when her alarm went off. And you know what she did? She hit the snooze. Hey, look at me. You ain't slept until you sleep after the snooze button. Look, it either too hot or it's too cold. But after the snooze button, tell me I don't know. It's all good. You know what I'm saying? Your bed too lumpy, your bed too soft, too hard. After the snooze, you're sleeping on a cloud up in there. You ain't had no dream until you dream after the snooze. Somebody clap for the preacher this morning. Something about that snooze button makes everything right. But how many of you know reality coming? The sun's a little higher than it normally is. The birds are singing louder than they usually are when you get up. All of a sudden, you realize you got to go. That was Shannon. She jumped up. She got her stuff. She got in her little car. She's driving down the two-lane road, corn on the left, corn on the right. She's getting to school. I don't know if you've ever done this, but has anyone here ever been flying down I-85 and you look in your rearview mirror and there's a car coming up on you like Mario Andretti? Anybody ever get over just to let this car go by? And as it goes by, you want to see who it is going that fast. And when the car comes by you, you realize, as you see, hold on with me. First, it's a lady. No disrespect to ladies, it's all good. Except this lady got one hand on the rearview mirror and the other hand on her lip gloss. And she driving. Who driving? Now look, I got some ladies looking at me like, excuse me. So I know, lady, I know. You got to have the lip gloss. I understand. If you get in a wreck and it comes down to you living or dying, that paramedic ain't gonna touch your lips if you ain't got lip gloss on there. I know, but this lady was fine. Now, I got to tell you, that's what Shannon was doing. She was putting on her lip gloss, and she was looking, she was being safe, and I guess she looked a little long in the rearview mirror because all you heard was boom, and when she did, she hit her brake. All she remembers seeing when she stepped out of the car, she thought it was a deer or a dog, but then she saw a bicycle. When she woke up, she was back in bed. She thought she was dreaming till she saw her mom and dad sitting in the corner of her room. Her dad said, baby, do you love me? He said, yeah, do you trust me? Yes, yeah, sis. You hit a lady. Her name was Marjorie, and she just passed away. She started to weep and cry. The doctor gave her medicine to give her. She went back to sleep. She heard the phone ringing after she woke up, and her dad had a sandwich, said, take a bite. She took a bite. He goes, do you love me? She goes, yes. Do you trust me? I said, we have to go. We have to go somewhere. We got to be there by 5 o'clock today. If we go at 5 o'clock, they will not press any charges against you. Now we've made this the most depressing sermon in the history of your church, okay? So here's what I want to do. Now this only works, so I need key, somebody, give me a little something, something. You know what I'm saying? Everybody clap for the music guys. They know what they're doing. They're going to drop a little something for me on there. Everybody look at your neighbor and say, wow, we're going to beat the Baptist to the buffet. That was my goal. When I woke up, I heard Jesus say, we're not going to let them get all the white chicken today. I would say beat the Catholics, but they've been out of church for about an hour and a half already. That's just wrong. Everybody touch your neighbor and say, here we go. Touch your other neighbor and say, here it is. So let's go back. Tara. Do y'all remember where Tara is? Hospital. Yeah. What are they going to do in an hour? Yeah. Oh, yeah. I love it. One guy, he just blind goes, she dead. How about they're going to turn off the machine that's keeping her alive? That was a little bad. The brother in the back, he went, dead, man. So here it is. Tara's mom and dad, they moved her to a room. The machine was pumping. That's all the mom could hear. All of a sudden, she looked up, and coming down the hall was the doctor. As the doctor was coming down the hall, she knew it had only been 20 minutes. So she went out in the hall and closed the door. She went, no. It's only been 20 minutes. You said 1 hour. And the doctor said, listen, every time something like this happens, I do anything I can to find hope. He goes, I got to tell you, by law, I have to tell you, there's a girl in Phoenix, Arizona. She needs a new heart. And your daughter's a perfect match. I only have 10 minutes before I have to make a decision. We got to call a jet. But I need your permission. I am simply asking, can I have your baby's heart? He goes, I can give you 5 minutes to decide. When he came back, she was in the hall. She looked at him and said, don't say yes, don't say no. I'm just here to tell you this. Everything in your power, you need to do. Next year, December 26th, I need to go to Phoenix and meet this girl. Promise me you'll do whatever it takes. He goes, I promise. Fast forward 1 year. December 26th, a mom and dad gets on a plane. Instead of going skiing with their little girl to go to Phoenix, Arizona, at the carousel to get their luggage, guess who's there? The doctor from Denver. He said, I took vacation days. I have a rental car out front. I'm going to take you to see them. They want to see you now. They get in the car and they drive to a community, pretty nice houses. When they pull up in the front of a house, there's a man and a woman standing outside. Let me stop right there and explain something to you. When you know someone has given life where death lived, you don't let them knock on your door. When you know someone has made a miracle up in your life, you don't let them ring your doorbell. Even though the Bible says in Revelations, I stand at the door and knock. If any man comes to me, I will come to him. You got to understand, this is Jesus. He's the one who let his life go so that you can have a life. He's the one who died so that you could be risen again. He's the one that was the sacrifice. When you realize who he is, you meet him in the front yard of your life. The door, they got out of the car, everybody's hugging, everybody's crying, even the doctor's crying. But what this couple didn't know, the doctor had already been to the house. He hooked that girl up to a monitor. And when they went in the house and opened the front door, the whole house, all you can hear was boom, 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 boom. All you can hear was that baby's heart just banging away. And she goes, that's my baby. Don't you get it? The day you decide to let Jesus be Lord of your life, the day you decide to give him your life, he does great physician. He takes your nasty, earthly, messed up, sinful heart, and he doesn't transplant it with a new heart. He gives you Jesus's heart. Even in death, we win. Somebody touch your neighbor and say, everything's going to be all right. Hey, it's only going to get worse from here. Do y'all remember Heather? You remember, where's Heather? She's in on a Delta airline from Johannesburg to Atlanta. Where's Heather? She's in the bathroom praying that God heals her dad. She was in that bathroom 45 minutes. How do we know? Because after 45 minutes, somebody was knocking on the door. Who be knocking on the door? Have you ever seen a bathroom on an airplane? If you go in and lock the door, it says occupied. If you see occupied, why are you knocking? So she just slid the lever, opened the door. There's three men standing there. She looks at them, and one of them says, ma'am, we're doctors, and you've been in there 45 minutes. If you're sick, we can help you. And she went, no. And she began to explain about her dad. He's in 21A. She'd been explaining he's allergic reaction. I'm trying to get him to Atlanta. An ambulance is waiting, but I don't think his vitals are dropping. I don't think he's going to make it. I don't think. And one of the three guys looked at the other two, and they all three started laughing. Hold on. She just told them her dad is dying in row 21, seat A. And their response was to laugh. And she from Atlanta. All she did was reach up and started taking off an earring. Oh, don't even try. You from Winston-Salem, North Carolina. If a sister takes off an earring, it's about to go down. Y'all know what I'm talking. Don't come up in church acting like you ain't all that. All of a sudden, one of the guys goes, no, ma'am. Okay, this makes me really happy. Y'all, okay. He goes, no, you don't understand. We're not just three doctors. There are 99 doctors on this plane. We're going to Atlanta for the World AIDS Conference. The medicine your dad needs, it's in my bag. I'm in row 22, seat eight. Okay, hold on. Everybody say, hold on, wait a minute. They could have been on any plane at any time. They could have been on a plane with a bunch of clowns going to a clown convention, but they were not. They could have been on a plane with a bunch of plumbers who needed to pull up their pants and say no to crack, but they were not. They were on the right plane at the right time, at the right moment. You're in the right church at the right time, at the right moment. I don't know what you need this morning, but he does. Touch your neighbor and say, everything's gonna be all right. You know, this is going exactly how I planned it in my head. Go ahead, sit down. I'm almost done. With God for us, who can be against us? I'll say it again. If God be for us, who can be against us? Hold up. Hey, you remember that little boy? 6 years old, go to school, ain't got no last name. 13, want to give up on life. Foster care dad walks in his bedroom. Check this out. Foster care dad walks in the bedroom. Little boy says, why did you sleep by my door? And he says, because I love you. And the boy says, nobody loves me. My own mom gave me away. And the man said, you can't change your past, but you can change your future. And the boy says, how can I change my future? And the dad reached in his back pocket and pulled out a Gideon Bible. It was orange. And he started reading, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Then he went to Romans and he read, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Then he went to Romans 10:9 and he said this to the little boy. He says, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Do you believe what I'm saying? And the boy said, yes, I do. And then the man said, do you want to say that prayer with me? And the boy said, yes. And the man said, repeat after me, Reggie. I had no name when I was six. I grew up in the foster care system my entire life. My mom slept with a man for $20 to get food for my brother and my two sisters. That's why I was born, and that's why I was a mistake. But my past is my history and my future is my destiny. Why? Everything's gonna be all right. Everything's gonna be all right. Are y'all listening to me this morning? I just thought I should put myself in the story. Everything's gonna be all right. Everything's gonna be all right. I gotta finish it. Touch your neighbor and say, everything's gonna be all right. I speak to 1.2 million public school students every year, and they want that story. Tomorrow, I'll be in 5 high schools in New York. Tomorrow afternoon at 3:30, I will have spoken to 15,000 kids and told them there's hope, there's hope, there's hope. What do you need him to do this morning? Are y'all listening to me? What do you need him to do? What do you need from the king this morning? Trust in him. Trust in him. Awesome. I'm going to start at 15 and I'm going to go to zero. When I start at 15 and work my way down to zero, you know what you're carrying today. You know what you're carrying and that you shouldn't be carrying. What do you say, church family? Let's give it to God this morning. So I'm going to go 15, 14. I'm going to go all the way to zero. Whoever's standing when I get to zero, you're saying, I'm done carrying this. I'm done. I'm trusting in God. He said, trust in me. I'm trusting in Jesus today. He said, cast all your cares upon me. I'm casting this. I've carried it long enough. I don't need to leave this church with it. And by faith, I'm giving it to Jesus. And we want to pray with you. You ready? If you're carrying something you need to let go of, you got 15 seconds. A lot of goals. Here's what I get. Why you always do this? Why you make people stand up? Because moving is physical, prayer is spiritual. And in a room like this right now, if you do something physical and spiritual, supernatural can happen in your life. Supernatural can happen in this room this morning. That's why you're gonna stand. Everybody who has a need, 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, in Jesus' name, 1. You thought you were standing by yourself. Look around the room. We in this thing together. We're going to fight together. We're going to love Jesus together. Hey, if somebody's standing near you, if your whole row is standing, put your hand on somebody. Say, you pray for me, I'll pray for you. Let's do this right now. Everybody, Jesus, I pray right now. You know what they're going through. You know the hurt. You know the sorrow. You know the need, and you are the answer. So I pray right now, God, before we hit the parking lot, that our souls would know that everything's gonna be all right. Our spirit would know that it's gonna be okay. No matter what tomorrow holds, you hold tomorrow and you hold us today. Jesus, thank you for the answer. Thank you for the answer. In Jesus' name, everybody say amen. Don't sit down. Hug the person beside you and say, everything's gonna be all right. Tell them, I gotta go. Now sit down. One last thing. Before I go, can I do one last thing? Let me ask you something. Do you know him? No, do you know my Jesus? He can make a way out of no way. He can turn your darkness into day. He did what he did so that you can do what you can do today. I need to give somebody an opportunity to become a follower of Jesus Christ. What my foster care dad did for me when I was 13, I would like to do for you now. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him. I like that word, whosoever. That's all of us. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. If you declare with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. When I was a kid growing up, I heard a song. And yesterday, a friend of mine sent me a video from Whitney Houston's funeral, believe it or not. And my friend goes, bro, remember when we were kids? Do you remember this song? I can't believe they sung it at Whitney's funeral. I said, I know. And this is a song I'm going to end with, but you're going to have to respond. Oh, by the way, I'm old school. I don't know if y'all figured that out yet. You'll understand in a second. The song simply said, Jesus said, here I stand. won't you please let me in? And you said, I will tomorrow. Jesus said, I am he who supplies all your needs. And you said, I know, but tomorrow. Tomorrow. Who promised you tomorrow? Better choose the Lord today, for your tomorrow may never come your way. That song flooded my heart when Pastor was standing here speaking of an 18-year-old boy who lost his life last Wednesday. Who am I? I don't even know what tomorrow holds for me, but I do know who holds tomorrow. So I'm gonna ask you to do me a favor. Somehow, some way, from the balcony to the floor, you realize that you have sin in your life. But your heart's starting to pound really heavy right now. It's almost like the whole room disappeared and I'm looking straight at you. You need Jesus. So I'm gonna start at 25 and work my way to zero. Pastor Hash Marie, could you come and just stand right here? Just face your family. I don't know who this is for, but I'm gonna tell you right now. Something happens when you walk for Jesus. Something supernatural. I don't care who you are. I don't care where you're sitting, but you're a sinner. And today you want to come home. You got 25 seconds to get from your seat to stand in front of your pastors. If you want Jesus, you know you're wrong. 25, 24, 23, 22, 21, 20. 19, 18, 17, 16, 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10. Oh, this is where the pressure comes. Look at your neighbor, look at your friend, look at your loved one and say, let's go. You know who needs to get here? 9. You know who needs Jesus? 8. You know who needs to be set free? 7. You know it's you. Come on. 6. Keep coming. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Five. Come on over. 4. 3. There's room. 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 Somebody help me. Look at your neighbor and say, come on, let's go. Let's go. I'll go with you. I'll walk with you. I'll walk with you. Is there anybody else? Come on. Age got nothing to do with this. Bring the children unto me, he said. Oh, come on, 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 come on. Come to Jesus. Come on, come on, come on. They're still coming. Oh, come on, church. Come on, church. Hey, do me a favor. Oh, they're still coming. Come on, come on, come on, come on. We gotta do this. Everybody ready? Stretch your hands toward them. If you're in your seat and you're like, I should have came forward, say this prayer with me. Go to the coffee shop, find one of the pastors and say, I said this prayer. Listen, we're doing Romans 10:9. Oh, by the way, I am so proud of you guys. So proud of you. Everybody, we're all saying it together. Why? There's a saint and there's a sinner. Every saint has a past and every sinner needs a future. And this is where it happens. So everybody in the room, say, Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Today, I choose you. I step over my past. I step over my shame. I step over my shame. So I'm still there. I step over my shame. I am worthy to be loved by Jesus. And in Jesus' name, there's no other name but Jesus' name, I'm saved. Amen. Amen, 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 amen. Hey, before our pastor closes, listen. I speak over this house salvation. I speak that in the next few weeks, hundreds will come, not just to church, but will come and find Jesus as their Savior and as their Lord. I speak that this is a church that is a lighthouse in a dark city. In a world that needs light, this church is the match. And it's time to light it up in the city of Winston-Salem. In Jesus' name.
Wow. Come on and give the Lord the ovation of the morning. Hallelujah. God is good. And all the time. So good. Prayer team, deacons, elders, trustees, will you come down here and help us? We just want to pray with every single person that came forward to pray with Uncle Reggie this morning. That's great. Come on. Come on down. Prayer team, we need you. Church, would you stand with me? I just want to say thank you to our great, great man of God who preached for us this morning, Reggie Dabbs. This is a divine appointment. It came together. It was all Jesus. And I'm so grateful. I want to bless you, church, before you go anywhere. People that are down here in the altar, don't run away. Stick around because we have good things for you. We want to get connected with you. We want to spend time with you. We like you and we love you. And we want you to know that this church is a family. We are a weird-looking family, but we're a family. We're red, we're yellow, we're brown, we're black, we're pink, we're green, we're white, we're orange. There's even some blue devils in here, and we love you. But we are not complete without you. Will you raise your hands just like this? It's a symbolic gesture of receptivity to what God has for you. I bless you. I bless you in every effort in your heart to see your family live for God. I bless you that you will have the confidence to never give up. I bless you that you will walk in identity and understanding that you are God's baby, that He loves you, that He gave everything for you, and He'd do it again because you're worth more than gold to the Creator. He loves you. And I bless you that every dream you have, that God, even through the obstacles, will bring you to victory in your business, in your family, in your finances, in your education, in your life. I bless you in Jesus' name. We love you, church. Hug at least 5 people before you leave. I'll see you next Sunday. Rich Wilkerson will be here. It's going to be incredible. I'll see you next week. Boris, give it to us.